what I'm going to do is utilize some common like kitchen parts and make basically a resonator style guitar. First thing I'm going to use is one of these stainless steel strainers. But then what's going to happen, that's actually going to sit, you know, I'll cut out that hole, sink that down in there. And once that's sunk in there, I'm going to take another stainless steel bowl. This one has a really good ring to it, is why I'm using it. I go around like Goodwills and stores and things, tapping on things to see how they sound when you tap on them. But anyway, this will work real good, you'll see. But this bowl is going to flip upside down and sit in there like so. And then on top of that, like most resonators on top of their cone, it'll have a wooden biscuit, not this big, I just had this laying here. It'll be about the size of the top of this. And that biscuit will sit on top, and then you'll have your bridge across there. Then I also have these little sink strainers, and you notice they have about the same size holes in them that that strainer there has. So I'm actually going to cut a couple of sound holes and put those in there. And I'm going to use a kitchen cabinet hinge for your tailpiece. And then, like usual, I'm going to make my neck from scratch. So I'm using this red oak here to start with. You can see that's nice and straight. And then I've got a bunch of strips of red oak for the fretboard material as well. Instead of using the regular guitar fret wire, I'm going to do another one here where I use the little stainless steel blade inserts that come in your windshield wipers. It's real tedious and it takes longer than actually using fret wire, but I kind of like the fact that I'm using something that wasn't intended for a guitar. So I'm going to go ahead and do it one more time. As you'll note, I've already cut the hole in the top of the box here. That's going to be for this kitchen strainer. That's going to drop right down in there. The other thing I've done is I've begun to lay out the pickup location here. It's going to have a Fender single coil pickup in it, or at least that style. One little tip here, if you're going to do this sort of thing, if you can pick up things like this, this is just an old pick guard, but what I use it for is a template, and it helps me lay it out perfectly so that I know when I cut it out that it's going to match up exactly to the particular pickup that I'm using. And obviously this one back here is for a humbucker, but if you keep different pick guards around, or if you make your own templates, it just speeds things along. I've begun to put the neck together. I started with this red oak wood that I showed you last time. I cut the little slant in the headstock here, and then you'll see some lines on here. I've laid out where the nut's going to be. This is going to be where the fretboard ends. This neck is going to come into this box, and it's going to be cut, and it's going to have to go down, and then because it can't go through this, so it's not going to be a through neck, okay, in the conventional sense. So it's going to have to be braced up differently inside. But when I'm laying everything out, I lay it out on this board just like it's gonna be a through neck. And that way, like, see, I marked, this is the edge of the box. This is where that single coil is gonna go, that pickup. This is the edge of that strainer, and so on and so on. Here's that tail piece with the kitchen cabinet hinge. So I lay it out basically like it's gonna be a through neck, and then I'm gonna chop it up. You see, like, I'll chop this tail piece off, then I know what I've got to work with there. This middle section, this is where the stainless steel strainer is, so of course this part is just going to be gone. And then this is the part that's going to actually come into the box in front of the strainer, and then I'll have to build off of that to brace everything. And once everything's laid out on the neck, then I start building it up with the fretboard material. And in the case of mine, I usually end up with two of these, because they'll be the first one there, and then that will get it even with the top of the box here. But, you know, that first strip will make this flat and even. The reason being, then when I go with the next strip, it'll actually overlay the box like that, and that'll be my actual fretboard. I actually like it when the fretboard comes over the box, just like most guitars do, you know. You can see I've got the neck and the fretboard kind of roughed in. I've got the tuner holes drilled. As you can see, it's going to be a four string, and I've cut a little angle into the headstock, but that's just all rough cut. It's going to be, I'll smooth it and bevel this and round that off and that kind of thing. The neck's going to be made up of three pieces of wood. This is all red oak, and I just laminated the three pieces together by using wood glue and clamping it. You can still see the divisions between them right now, but when I'm done and it's final sanded and everything, it'll basically just mold together like one piece of wood. And as you can see, I overlapped these two pieces, but that's just because I'm going to come back and sand this into like a smoother curve down to the headstock here. You see I've cut out a section for the nut, which in my case is actually going to be this brass bolt. This is a 5/16 brass bolt, and I found out that this thread spacing works out really well. The strings sit in there just fine. This is kind of unusual design, obviously, but with this fretboard being so high off the headstock, it gives me a nice breakover angle that keeps good tension on the strings. The way this is made, once it's all measured out, you know, take your T-square, make sure it's nice and straight, I just take a hacksaw, like this little mini hacksaw here, and I'll just cut down a portion, you know, just a part of the way on each line, and then I'll make a couple more cuts across, and then I'll just chip that out, like with a pocket knife. And then I take a round file and go through there until it gets to be just perfect to hold that bolt in there. Then the rest of the fretboard, it's marked out. This is on a 25.5-inch Fender scale, you know, the common Fender guitar scale. When I say scale, for those that don't know, that means the distance that the string is vibrating, basically. So it's from the nut here to the bridge, which in the case of this, you know, resonator style guitar, is going to be right here in the middle of this steel bowl on this biscuit here. That's just a really common scale. The other one that's most common would be like a Gibson, which is like a 24.75-inch scale, which actually is a pretty good scale too because it's a little bit slinkier. But anyway, once I laid it out, made the marks in pencil, and then I scored them with a razor knife as well, and you can actually feel a little groove in there, you know. I've marked them for depth and just ensure that I get everything exactly how I want. Now, on this one, I'm using the stainless steel strips that come in windshield wipers. And that's what I'm going to use for frets. I've done these many, many times, and they hold up really well. But they don't have like the little shoulder on them like fret wire does, so it's much harder to get these perfectly level. It takes a lot of practice to get them just right. And to make it even harder, in a way, I'm not even using a fret saw, which would have like a depth gauge. I'm actually just using a junior hacksaw like this. And the reason being, I just found out through trial and error that these particular blades in this saw make a cut. You know, the saw kerf is exactly the right size for this particular blade, okay? And it works out really well. I don't recommend doing this. If you're building guitars, get a fret saw, use fret wire. It's much easier. I'm just doing this because I want to, and that way it's, you know, totally handmade with as few guitar parts as possible. I managed to get the fret slots cut in, and that went really well. You know, they're looking nice and straight, so that's good. I did take, let's see here, I took a couple pieces of this neck material that I was using. I glued them side by side, like so. You can see the line right there. Clamped that for a while. When that got good and solid, I sanded all this down and shaped it. And as you can see, once you start sanding it, you can't even hardly see the line between the two. And then what that's going to be is this little heel here, as you can see. And then once I get this neck all sanded, and, you know, this, I'm going to glue this heel on here. I'll sand this all like one unit. And then it'll just be smooth like it's one piece of wood. That'll add, you know, just add some style to it, but also it's going to add some strength because that's going to be bracing up against the outside of the box here. What I've started to do here, if you remember, this was three boards thick that I glued up, and which is way too thick. So then what I do, I draw kind of a curve there and start sculpting it out. But then when I'm done, it'll be substantially thinner, and it'll also be rounded around here to fit your hand really nicely. Right now you can see it's really roughly cut. All I've been doing right now is I take this old draw knife, this antique draw knife. I start carving away at, you know, the larger chunks, get it down to the rough shape, and then I'll start sanding it. And I'll use a block to sand it at first. Then I'll switch over to actually just put the sandpaper in my hand and run it up down the neck here. Until it feels exactly the way I want it to. I've been doing a lot of work on the neck, as you can see. I've added this heel piece to here. I've begun to do a little shaping on the neck itself. It's got a little curve to it now instead of just being a big flat block. Now, I do build the necks a little bit on the thick side. I just don't like the feel of the real thin neck because it's a fairly narrow neck anyway. And then with thinness, I don't feel like I can get the kind of pressure on there that I want. So I do leave the necks a little thicker. And then they're much more resistant to bowing that way. Commonly, you'd have, 21, 22 frets on electric guitar. I've actually, or maybe 24, but I've actually chosen 23 frets just because I was just talking to my son yesterday or the day before, and he was telling me how 23 was his favorite number. So I put 23 in here. This overhang is because that's actually going to overhang the top of the box a bit. You might notice I've cut a notch out here. That's for the single coil pickup to sit down in there. And I cut it a little big just to give a little wiggle room there, room for wire, that kind of stuff. Now, let me show you how this neck goes into the box, and so you can kind of see how this is all going to work out in the end here. As you can see, that part slid through an opening that I had cut in there, and that meets right up to this strainer here, like the resonator assembly. And I've kind of radiused it to match that curve. You can see that that heel is going to match up just perfectly to that level of the box. And then I have another block here that was glued up from three different blocks, and you can see once you start sanding a little bit, it looks like one. And that's actually going to fit right there, like so. This heel is going to be glued to the box, this block's going to be glued to the box, and then this is all going to be glued together like one big unit, okay? So that is going to be extremely strong. You'll notice there's a little gap right here. So there's going to be another piece that slides in under there and is all glued up as well. And that will make it one solid unit all the way to the lid of the, to the top of the box. Then, back here, I took another piece of that neck material and I cut that out real nice. And that slid through to the inside here. And I radiused that the same way. Of course, I'm going to have a tail piece on there. And so the tension's going to be pulling, upward on that. So you have to brace this up a little bit. So what I've done, I've cut this triangular shaped piece here. I guess, what is that, trapezoidal? But anyway, so this width down here is the same as that neck. That's going to slide in there, and it's going to get glued to the back wall of the box. Now, you'll wonder what these cutouts are for. Well, what I've done here, I scavenged the back of a chair. This is the slat that would be in the back of a dining room chair, like so. And I cut it down to size and sanded all the finish off because I'm going to refinish it. This is actually going to sit... here, let me line this up. Okay, that's going to be the same size as the back of that there. All right. Okay, so you can see how nicely that fits. Okay, it's going to come right up to the edge of the box there and right to the edge back there. Since this isn't like a typical through neck design of a normal, cigar box guitar, it's going to come through and then this is going to be screwed in to those blocks below. And then that's just going to add a lot of rigidity to the whole thing. Because you got these blocks all glued up, and then you got this cross piece, so it's almost going to be as strong as if it had a through neck on it. This happens to be the perfect thickness that when this lid closes, it closes nice and tight, but that lid is actually, just right above here. I mean, just everything just barely fits, and it's going to be nice and snug. I just picked that piece because, I think it has a really cool look to it in it, and I'm going to actually finished out and do some painting and different things inside the box too to make it really interesting. This is the material I'm using for frets. It's stainless steel. It's just a strip that comes inside a set of wiper blades. As you can see, I've got a bunch of them laid here. That's just rough cut ones. You can do this on a bench grinder like we have out in the shed, but I actually like doing it with the hand drill because I can modulate the speed of it just by, minutely while I'm doing it. So I can take off more or less, depending on what I want to do here. And then what I do is I do them one at a time, and then I actually measure them to the fretboard again, and then come back, do a little bit more until it's like perfect. And then you just kind of rotate it. Yeah, I just kind of roll it onto there, and that'll give it, I don't know if you can see that or not, but it'll give it a nice rounded profile, a little shoulder on it. You can see it's starting to get that rounded profile on that one that I was working on. On these, I've actually got them dry fit in there. Right now, it's a snug fit, but I am able to very carefully press them down in there, and I can take this little tool I have and actually push them back out. And then I'm actually going to glue them and tap them into place when it's all final. But as you can see, they're already starting to look pretty nice. You can see each one has nice rounded little corners. And then actually I will install and glue all these in, and then I'll come back and finish sand my neck. And that way, if there's anything sticking out at all, which you can see there's not very much, you know, if there is any, but if there is, it'll be sanded smooth. And that way it'll feel real nice when you're playing. Now, after it's strung up and everything, if I find out there is a high spot here and there, of course I could file it down a little bit and make them, you know, perfect. But, and you can see it's looking pretty good. Like I said, there could still be a little bit of finishing work, just like when you're doing regular frets. It's the same way. You still have to work them over a little bit once everything's together. But it turned out pretty nice, I think, especially for using a material that's not intended for guitars. So you can see I've cut the hole for the single coil pickup, and that still needs a little bit of finish work, but I'm gonna wait till I get the pickup slid up in there, and then I can make sure everything's perfect. So I did drill out these sound holes, which if you recall are gonna have these little strainer pieces in them. What I used to drill that out is one of these just little hole saws. Now there are other, what are they called, Fastener bits, that kind of thing. There's other things that actually cut cleaner holes, but this will do the job. And it just so happens that this was the exact size I needed. In fact, it was just a hair smaller than the bottom of the strainer, which is what I like, because then I can cut the hole, and then as you can see, it's real close to going in, but not quite. And that's what you want, because I want to be able to tailor it so that it's a really tight fit. And that's what I've done here. You can see how snug that goes in there. I mean, that would even hold in there without glue. When you drill a hole like that, and it's just a hair small and you need to sand it out, instead of using like your finger or something like that, of course you can use a drum sander, you know, like on a drill press or something like that, but what I've done is just improvised and made myself kind of a hand drum sander by just taking an object, which in this case is just a little container of craft paint, you know, but it happened to be about the right size. And then I wrap that sandpaper around there nice and snug. And then what I do is just go in there. And that gives you a radius that's, I mean, very close to the radius of the hole, so that when you sand this out, you're not gonna gouge it out or make it oblong or whatever. And you just try to kind of work your way around and not stay in one place too long. Something else I've been working on is I took these little decorative moldings, and I've got a number to make sure, because I fit them to each corner as perfectly as I can. But what that's going to do is just add some rigidity to the box, you know. The top of those are going to strengthen up, you know, the top a bit. And it's just going to hold these corners together a little sturdier, just to make sure that's good and stout. I just finished basically getting everything mocked up. And all I have left to do now is the staining and the painting and installing the electrics, that kind of stuff. So you can see I've got the tail piece on there. I've got a latch here to latch the lid shut, and I've got the strainers in there for sound holes, and then here in the little resonator assembly, let me get this out, you can see that wood right below here, and what I'm going to do is right in the center hole, I'm going to put a single screw there as well. That's just to make sure that this stays seated down the way it's supposed to, although, you know, the string pressure will hold it down. For the most part when it's together. But you can see I've got the tuners in there and the nut in there. The neck's starting to look pretty smooth. If I can get this out of here, I can give you a quick look inside. Alright guys, I got the box open, and you can kind of get an idea of what it's going to look like. As you can see, this piece is installed, so that's really solidifying everything from the neck to the tailpiece. This just fits in there perfect. That just is just below that, so it should support it really well. I've got these little corner pieces once again holding that, making that a little stronger. And then over here, if you see the circle piece with the cutout, what that is, I made a corresponding tab here, so when this lid shuts, that tab slides into here and snugs it up a little bit before the latch is even on there. I've still got a little fine tuning to do, and then I'm going to come back and start doing the finishing work. This is going to be stained. Then this back in here is going to be all painted around in there. And I believe I'm going to stain these corners. So, but anyway, it's getting there. Since the last time you've seen it, I stained the box. That's a walnut stain on there. You can see I used that kitchen cabinet hinge for the tailpiece. And then I've got basically like a Gibson style jack plate there with the quarter inch jack. And then if we can see that, I made a little piece of hardwood there underneath the tailpiece. And that's where the guitar strap holder goes. And that way it's got some good hardwood on the inside and the outside for that to go into, so it's good and sturdy. I've got a brass clasp here to hold the box shut. Of course, you know about the strainer and the stainless steel bowl. And then I made a wooden biscuit out of red oak. And it's got a piece of threaded rod for a bridge. And then you can see the little strainers there for sound holes. And you might notice there's a little switch in there. That's a mini switch. And that little toggle switch actually turns on a microphonic pickup that's inside the bowl. And then I can flip it and go just to the single coil here as well. And I may end up swapping that single coil out. That's just an old one I had laying around here. But I wanted to get it together. It works pretty well, actually. You can see I stained the fretboard as well. And those are brass tacks for fret markers. You can see the bolt for a nut there. And I did add like a fender style string tree there for those two longer strings, just to keep them at the angle I want. Over here, you've got the hinges for the box, obviously. This is the tone and volume control. Those are actually inset into a closet pull, a closet handle. And I thought that worked pretty good. One of the more unique features is actually inside the box. So let's take a look at it here. So you can just open this up like a typical box. And I've got these tabs in here that hold it pretty snug even when it's not latched. But anyway, when you get inside, you can see that I've stained that neck piece there. I think that turned out pretty nice. My wiring here, I used some little brass hold downs, like brass picture hangers is what those are, and they hold my wiring where I want it. And I ran it down here because I didn't want it to show through those holes of the strainer. So that's why they're where they're at. The last thing in here is on the lid. I actually painted Robert Johnson, who's considered the king of the Delta blues. And you might know the story of him selling his soul to the devil at the crossroads and all that. So I put him at the crossroads here, and I actually cut it off so I made it look like a cross as well. And then he's sitting on a tree stump and playing his old guitar with the thumb pick. Hopefully you guys can see that. It's so glossy because I polyurethaned it, so it's a little hard to get it. But and then it says Rambling On My Mind, because obviously my channel is Rambling Around, but also he has a really good song called Rambling On My Mind, so I thought that was fitting. And then down below him, I just painted his name so people would know, you know, anybody that wasn't familiar would know who he is. And then of course I signed it just like any other painting, so. But, you know, I think it's a unique instrument for sure. And hopefully you guys like it. I'm gonna go inside and get out the amp and play it a little bit for you so you can see what it sounds like.